that she was allowed to graduate. I think that says everything about his kindness, his care, his love. That was more important than anything else.
Is there anyone else? I'm Eric Weinstein. I'm Fred's son-in-law. I do want to encourage anybody else who has memories not be afraid to take the microphone. I didn't intend to speak as his son-in-law, but I do have to comment now that I realize what standards the men who enter that family have to live up to. But I'm actually here to read. I'm actually here to read this on behalf of Gil Osgood, who's Fred's younger brother. So imagine if you, I think there's a picture of Gil in the program. Imagine that I am him. My brother Fred, he was my big brother, the oldest of us four siblings. I was the youngest, 13 years younger than he. We led very separate lives, and yet he was a major influence on me. He grew up in British India, while I spent most of my childhood in newly independent India. We even had different hometowns. His was Darjeeling, where he attended kindergarten through the 10th grade, before transferring to the Woodstock School in Mysore, which is my hometown, where I did all of my school. I was four when he left home for college, but I had one more wonderful year with him when I was 10 and he was 23. He was finishing college after his army service, and he moved in with the family during our furlough in 1951 and 1952 to help with expenses. He had to share a double bed with me in the small apartment that was all our missionary parents could afford. That year he took me to my first football game and my first baseball game. He showed me the new library, newly enlarged library on the University of Oregon campus, and he took me to the pool room in the new student union building. He taught me to play chess, and he worked on expanding my vocabulary. When our family took time on the coast, he and I went hiking along the beach, both of us jumping off a rock jetty into what at first seemed to be quicksand, but unfortunately wasn't. Our parents and I went back to India. We didn't see him again for nearly 7 years, but he continued to be a major influence in my life. Our mother often talked about him, listing for me all the books, like the Quran, that he read when he was hospitalized for rheumatic fever as a 13-year-old, telling me how brave he was when he went to the dentist, and many other stories. When we came back to the U.S., our first stop was in India to see Fred and meet his wife, Anne, and daughter, Cindy, for the first time. Fred and I immediately went hiking again, this time up the stream that ran by his apartment building. We had to turn back when an old woman threatened us with a shotgun. I followed his example by going first to Winfield College in Oregon, then serving in the Army before finishing college at the University of Oregon. During my Army service, I served a year and a half at Fort Meade, and I spent 1 week in a month with Fred, Ann, and Cindy and Rick, getting to know Fred as an adult, helping him paint the fence and pull poison ivy out of the backyard, visiting his office at the FAA. It was wonderful to have a home to go to and a family to spend Christmas with. Our adult lives were spent on opposite sides of the country, but they were frequent visits. His last visit was for the memorial service for our sister Lou back in November. Near the end of that visit, I asked him if he had really been as brave at the dentist as our mother claimed. I was amused when he modestly admitted that he was even braver than she knew because he once had a root canal without anesthesia. Our mother had told us separately that she had her boys first and last because we were supposed to take care of our sisters. When our sister Janet died when she was just 74, Fred said he felt like he had somehow failed to protect her, although her cancer, of course, had nothing to do with him. I told him at the end of his last visit that I would appreciate it if he would defer his own death for a while, so I wouldn't have to lose another sibling. That was not to be. I like to think that after Lou died, he felt he had fulfilled my mother's request to look out for her sisters, and that it was okay for him to go to. He had a long life, longer than any other male member of our family, but I still wanted more. I don't think I could have had a more loving and caring brother. I shall listen.
Thank you. That means you've been trying to get us.
Hello, I'm Alan Sock. I am a grandson of Eva Hawk Hess. And I would like to play a song, one of my favorites, A River Flows to You, in honor and remembrance of Fred.
For a very long time. We are teachers, both of us. I had a hard time making it here today, but I'm so happy that the Lord heard my prayers. So we could come here because of the terrible weather. And I just agree with everyone here about Fred and Eva too. I think they're wonderful people, both of them. And thank you for the wonderful music. And I think the words and everything we've heard here today has been, it has been love pouring down from above. That's what I feel. So I'm so happy to be a part of this today, this sermon, I said. It's a sermon for me, a sermon of love. And I think that sometimes I get into thinking about problems and I kind of blow them up and so. But I have learned something today, and I learned it by Fred. When you talked about Fred, I heard it, break it down into parts. That's one thought I got. And it will all work out in due season. That is what I will remember. It's wonderful. And God bless you all. And thank you, Eva, for having me here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we're ready for the presentation.
Thank you. Cool.